A friend is lending me space in his heated fabrication facility to help me finish my plant imaging system. There were weeks this winter where it was negative 11 degrees Fahrenheit in my garage in the morning, and plants simply don't survive temperatures like that. I built this machine to help ag biotech researchers compare different treatments, such as microbial treatments, applied to plants, in the hope that one of those treatments will help the plant to produce more food. An experiment will consist of dozens of trays like this one that can weigh up to 20 pounds depending upon the material that they contain and if they've been watered. So ergonomics of a system like this are really important. To help with ergonomics of this machine, I made this sliding platform that allows the technician to lift the tray off, hang it off of their ligaments, bring it to a trolley, pick up a new one, bring it back to the platform. They'll then slide the platform back into position. A proximity switch detects whether or not the tray has been returned to position, and then they close the door. The rest of the video is the assembly of this sliding platform with all the mistakes and all the gotchas that I made. I hope that you learn something from it and can apply it to your own project.
Before making the parts, I want to give an overview of the design. This is the module that I'm making in this video, and it connects to existing extrusions in the frame of the machine by four screws and T-slot nuts. The two telescoping rails are cradled by right angle extrusions that also connect the frame of the machine to a steel plate. A proximity switch and steel target are used to detect when the sliding platform is in position. An additional right angle extrusion is used in the front to protect people's fingers from a pinch zone. The steel plate has mounted to it a handle and four more smaller right angle extrusions to help register the tray in the center of the sliding platform. All the miscellaneous hardware, such as the screws, came from McMaster, as did the right angle extrusions. The proximity switch came from Automation Direct. The telescoping rails and the aluminum extrusion hardware came from Misumi, as did the steel plate. I started by cutting the right angle extrusions to length and then trimming their width down, first on the bandsaw, which just left a mess, and then finally on the mill. The mill doesn't have sufficient travel, so the extrusion was milled in sections. This actually works better than it may seem at first. I've milled larger pieces on this PM25 mill. It's just a matter of, can you get the section that you need to work on into position on the mill? All the holes were simply laid out and then drilled at the drill press. Everything that's been screwed together has enough play that it doesn't have to be super precise. Even the telescoping rails have some tolerance for misalignment, but if you're going to pay attention to any particular detail, it's that the pair of telescoping rails are as closely aligned as possible. Since these are full extension telescoping rails, they consist of three sections and they have this neat gravity-assisted mechanism for sequencing those sections properly. You can see the hole that we had to drop the screw down through to attach the rail to the extrusion. The screws that hold these rails in place are not very big compared to the bulk of the rest of the hardware. Maybe the right angle extrusion doesn't have to run the full length of the rail. It's not adding any additional support, but it does protect the rail from dirt and keeps people's fingers out of it. And the right angle extrusion doesn't have to be as thick either, but it does give the screws more material to grab a hold of. I've made machines similar to this before, and a problem that I'd have with those is people wouldn't get the tray all the way into position. And then I was left with images that were skewed. So for this machine, I wanted to have a proximity switch that detected when the tray was fully in position and wouldn't let people take images unless the tray was in position. The proximity switches work better at detecting steel than aluminum. So I had this small piece of steel that I've milled slots into and contoured after attaching it to aluminum block by super glue. By using steel as a target instead of aluminum, you can double the distance between the proximity switch and the target. The proximity switch is held in place with a couple of jam nuts to give some adjustment. The distance between the proximity switch and the target is only about half a millimeter for steel, and if using aluminum, that ideal distance halves. For the steel top plate, all of the holes can be laid out and drilled by hand. Because the through holes have some slop to them, we don't need the accuracy to justify the time at the mill. The right angle extrusions can be clamped in the position and then match drilled. As always, can't overstate how nice it is to have a plan in the form of drawings before starting a project. To help ensure that the technician has the tray centered, I added these right angle extrusions all the way around that help to register the tray into the middle of the sliding platform. These small right angle extrusions are held into place using screws into tapped holes in the steel plate. Two of the edges are in a fixed position to have only round holes, while the other two edges have slots to give some amount of adjustability. Surprisingly, the dimensions of the greenhouse trays or flats are pretty consistent between manufacturers. To subdivide a tray, there are inserts available. The camera is behind the machine with the back panel removed. Now I just want to test fit the module and see if everything is working. It attaches to the machine by four screws into aluminum extrusions that are part of the frame. The telescoping rails easily disassemble, but when reassembling them, be careful to not harm the cage that holds the bearings. It's pretty easy to bend that cage. Not clear in the video is the amount of rubbing that's taking place, especially when the sliding platform is loaded. The right angle extrusions have a large inner radius, and that's interfering with the telescoping rails. So at the mill, I removed that inner radius. I couldn't use the same setup as before, but the extrusion still needed to be supported on the bottom where milling, so I could only mill about 6 inches at a time, but I got the job done. The need to do this could have been avoided by moving the telescoping rail away from the corner. I just didn't know this was going to be a problem until I ran into it, and I was trying to keep things pretty tight. The next time I make one of these, I'll probably change the position of the holes and avoid the need for that milling operation. Final steps are wiring the proximity switch and testing.
The PLC has three inputs. They're right here. The first one is the emergency stop. The second one is the door. And the third one is the tray sensor. There's roughly a quarter of an inch of travel of the tray while the sensor remains closed. Before we go, I want to say thank you for taking your time to watch this video. Thank you for being a subscriber, and an extra special thank you to those who contacted me the last couple months during which I haven't been posting videos. I got pretty sick in March, and during April I've had to prioritize to be sure that the things that needed to get done did get done. So until the next video, stay healthy.